Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the 10th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2022, which we are conducting in hybrid format this week. We have apologies from Natalie Dawn, MSP. At agenda item one, we have consideration of whether to take agenda items 3, 4 and 5 in private. Item 3 is consideration of evidence heard today in relation to skills and training. Item 4 is consideration of new evidence the committee has received in relation to carbon capture, utilisation and storage. And item 5 is consideration of the P&O Ferries Limited announcement last week in relation to staffing and services and the correspondence that the committee sent to P&O last week. Do we agree to take these items in private?
Agreed.
That is agreed. Thank you very much. Items 3, 4 and 5 will be taken in private. Our next agenda item is an evidence session in relation to our inquiry into the role of local government and its cross-sectoral partners in financing and delivering a Net Zero Scotland. This inquiry is also considering what role the Scottish Government and its agencies can play in supporting local government to deliver net zero targets. In January, we heard from local authorities, public sector leaders, community development bodies, the business sector and major private financiers. For the next part of this inquiry, we're looking at some of the key themes that emerged from the first half of the inquiry. And one of those themes is the role of the planning system in achieving net zero. And to discuss this theme, I'm pleased to welcome our panel this morning. That is Robbie Calvert, Policy, Practice and Research Officer, Royal Town Planning Institute; Jane Tennant, Chair, Scottish Young Planners Network, also RTPI; and Pam Ewan, Chair, Heads of Planning Scotland. Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for being with the committee this morning. We've allocated around 75 minutes for this session, and we will move straight on to questions. And the first question I have looks at the RTPI research, which highlights that nearly a third of planning department staff have been cut since 2019. That was part of your submission to the committee. And the committee has heard the practical difficulties arising from this shortage of planning officers. We heard from Scottish Renewables that the timeframe for completing a decision around planning can be up to 7 years, which obviously has a significant impact on projects being developed. RTPI has estimated that over the next 10 to 15 years, the planning sector will have demand for an additional 680 to 730 entrants into the sector. So my first question is it realistic to expect that this figure will be achieved? And what needs to happen for this target to be achieved? And perhaps with that question, maybe I can kick off with Robbie, to be followed by Pam and then Jane. So Robbie, over to you, please.
Thanks, convener. Good morning, everyone, and thanks for having me here today. So when we're thinking about this pipeline of planners that you just raised there, we have 680 additional entrants that we need over the next 15 years. And whether we achieve that or not very much depends on processes and things we've put into place now. So as part of that research, it identified about 100 graduates a year in terms of planning graduates coming out of our schools in Scotland. And this has very much remained quite a steady state output over the years. So we need to think quite creatively about how we bring more entrants into the sector. Now, compared to other sectors, 680 additional people into the sector isn't actually that significant. But as you just said there, in regards to Scottish Renewables and many other private sector organisations, they'll all flag planning as one of the crucial means by which we can deliver our sort of net zero ambitions. This is something actually I was a little disappointed when I was responding to the onshore wind policy statement. And actually, in regards to the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan as well, So both these documents, in terms of sort of identifying and flagging the kind of green jobs we need going forward, were very much based on the kind of manufacturing side of, for example, onshore wind turbines and issues around that. And although they briefly touch on the fact that we're going to need more of these kind of professional services, including planners, there was no real means to how we're going to actually achieve that or not. And so, yeah, noting things like the National Transition Training Programme or potential funding through the Energy Skills Partnerships, and we draw on some of those schemes to bring some much-needed funding for planning. And I think something we need to explore there is the establishment of an apprenticeship scheme. This is something we have established quite successfully down in England now. And it's something we are exploring in Scotland, and we're at the early stages of doing that. And so we've been jointly commissioned alongside Heads Planning Scotland and the Improvement Service to undertake some research on the matter. And this is called the Future Planners Project. So this is looking at how to sort of increase this pipeline of planners. So looking at things like awareness of planning as a career, and scopes into the profession, and the kind of effectiveness and of course the inclusion of a potential apprenticeship scheme. So that's due for publication in May and June. Just one other thing I want to touch on quickly as well, which I think is important to discuss, is in the research by Partners in Planning and Skills Development Scotland, not only did it identify this kind of issue of additional planners coming in, there's also a kind of succession planning issue that we have in planning authorities. So a lot of planning authorities have an ageing workforce, so we're just 9% of the workforce under 30 and then 35% over 50. We really need to consider in the short and medium term how we succession plan for this. And I think that's particularly important when we think about net zero, because there's a really high demand for this kind of middle tier planner. So that's team leaders and senior planners. And these are the kind of planners that are going to be dealing with major renewable infrastructure projects. You know, these need landscape capacity studies, zones of visual influence, landscape and visual impact assessment. So there's a range of relatively unique considerations in terms of development for planners, unique ecological impacts, construction on peatlands, for example, and aviation concerns. And these often require more senior planners within the planning authorities to deal with these applications. So I think in the short term as well, we really need to plan effectively for the large-scale retirement that we'll see over the next 5 to 10 years as well. So I'll stop there.
Thanks very much, Robbie. You mentioned a couple of points I know my colleagues want to follow up on, for example, on apprenticeships. But one follow-up question before I hand over to other panel members. The 680, 730 target for new entrants, does that take into account attrition levels? You mentioned that there's a number of planning officers are perhaps reaching the end of their careers and there's been significant attrition levels. So does that overall target take into account the expected attrition rate over the next 10 years?
Yes, it does. It does. One thing that target potentially doesn't take account of, and it's something I'm sure we'll get on to later on, is additional work coming online. And that's in consideration to, for example, the draft NPF4. So there's many additional assessments, new and expanded policies, a lot of additional and unfunded duties coming through in the Planning Act. So that will increase the burden on planning authorities and will require more planners to undertake this increased workload. So it could be that that figure is, in fact, an underestimate.
Okay, that's great. I'm sure we'll look at that again. Thank you, Robbie. We'll come back to you later. I wonder if I could pose the same question to Pam and then Jane, and feel free to pick up any of the issues that have been discussed so far.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. Yes, in respect of resources, planning and planners have a really important role to help achieve net zero across Scotland. However, there is that need to properly resource and also to skill. It's not just about having the numbers, it's making sure we have the skill sets in the right places. Robbie's touched on the Futures Planners Project, which we're very much is ongoing currently. And we're working with Tom Arthur, MSP, and Minister on that project. And that's going very, very well. And that's looking at recruitment, retention, and also promotion of planning as a career. One of the challenges we have is many people aren't aware of planning as a career. And what is fundamental is planning is part of the construction sector in Scotland, but it's also part of green recovery. And therefore, it sits fair and square and right in the heart of this agenda. So we do need to ensure that we've not just got the number of people and the resources to take forward the planning applications, take forward the intentions of the National Planning Framework for policies that are coming, but also to have that skill set there. One of the things I would touch on, and I'm sure we'll touch on the draft National Planning Framework 4 as we go through this session, but heads of planning were very disappointed that there wasn't a delivery plan alongside NPF 4 for consultation and comment. And we do expect and indeed hope that, that when that comes forward, that will look at this issue that is being raised about resourcing, proper resourcing of planning authorities to ensure the resources are there to deliver on the national policy intentions so that they are actually deliverable.
Thank you very much, Pam. Again, you've picked up a number of points that, we'll explore a bit, in a bit more detail. Jane, I wonder if I could turn to you in terms of your position as chair at Scottish Young Planners Network. Is planning seen, and obviously you can feel free to address whatever issues you want, but an additional question, is planning, you know, do you see a lot of interest from young people in choosing planning as a career, or is it a bit of a challenge to recruit younger people into the sector?
Thanks, Convener. I would say that awareness is definitely a key matter. Whilst I'm a young planner, I actually didn't find out about planning until I went back to uni at 28, and it wasn't probably until I was 30 till I properly formed the concept of it being a career and something I could work with for the rest of my life. And I have found that there has been, I think there's an issue in terms of the sort of careers advice out there, because even people that have come up behind me or are younger than me have also maybe went on and done a geography degree, which kind of makes sense, but they're not finding planning until they're part of the way into that degree, and there is undergraduate town planning degrees. So there's definitely an awareness issue there. I recently have been out to a geography society as part of one of the universities, and we gathered, there was quite a lot of people that attended our session for the RTPI. They were both politics and geography students. So I think there is the awareness issue. And then following through from that as well as universities, have a makeup of, you know, international and UK students, and keeping people in the country that have been skilled up here is maybe a bit of an issue. I know a lot of the people I shared my master's degree with have went back to their respective countries. So there's another issue potentially in there, and just getting that head count and attracting people to stay in Scotland and work in the planning system here.
Thanks very much, Jane. And just one follow-up question. In terms of attrition rates amongst, I guess, the younger planners network, are you seeing people leaving the sector, or is it fairly stable?
I think it's been fairly stable. I think it depends. I mean, you've got to remember as well, a lot of us come out of university and go into the private sector, and some of us are in the public sector. And generally, I think planners do tend to flip between them at times as well, especially in the early careers. So perhaps some people have went to the private sector, perhaps some people have maybe went into more economic development or sort of slightly related things. But I've not seen that myself, not attrition within the young people. I think our biggest problem is losing knowledge and understanding of the sort of major applications.
OK, thank you very much. And I've got a very brief follow-up for Robbie and Pam. Hiring, you know, planning officers is primarily a decision for individual local authorities, but looking at the challenges you've outlined in terms of budget, resource and expertise, would there be any merit in looking to pool planning resources across more than one local authority area so that you can maximise budget, resources and expertise? Robbie, and then Pam, please.
Pooling budgets in terms of hiring staff, I'm not sure. There's definitely a point there on regional planning, and we'll probably come on to that in a bit. A piece of work that we did, just thinking about resources more broadly, starting with the question, how much money does planning need to be effectively resourced? Ahead of the budget last year, we did a piece of work on that, and we established that over the parliamentary term, we needed £86 million into the system for planning to undertake its statutory duties. Now, a lot of that funding gap will be met through increase of fees. So there is the regulations to the fee increase that have been lodged. Of course, this is much welcomed, and it will bring much needed resource into the system. However, our work did not establish that would be enough for the planning system to undertake its statutory functions. And I think we need to be quite creative about how we bring funding into the system. So obviously with local government block grant arrangements, it's not for Parliament to say how local authorities spend their money necessarily, but there's other means by which we could bring other funding streams into the planning system. So our work identified the need for £24 million of that £86 million figure to come through such funding streams, and that would fund, for example, the Office of the National Planning Improvement Coordinator, local place plans funding, which I'm sure we can come on to as well, an apprenticeship scheme, and then some of the additional duties coming through in the planning at 2019. So, for example, funding for that apprenticeship scheme would benefit all planning authorities, undoubtedly. I don't know if Pam wants to come in on that.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, just, I mean, just a few things. Through Heads of Planning Scotland, we do a lot of sharing knowledge and sharing expertise. On occasion, resources can be used cross-authority to assist with some work. More recently, in the past 2-3 years, that hasn't proven possible. It's not to say that we haven't tried it across authorities, but there's simply not the availability of, shall I say, spare resource within an authority to facilitate that. But there's a real pressure just now in planning authorities across Scotland. There's been a very significant increase in planning applications through the past 10 years, both in terms of what we call household applications, which is your house extensions and your minor applications, but also the big major applications, you know, the larger developments coming forward. And actually that pressure has seen this, I certainly have noticed across authorities that perhaps there are more people choosing to retire a bit earlier than they otherwise would. And I certainly think the pressure of workload has had a role to play in that. It's not that we don't look at what the point you've raised. We do fundamentally look at that. Planning is quite different to other systems, such as building standards, where there are opportunities to take a national approach for part of that work. But I would like to assure you that that expertise and knowledge is shared across planning authorities.
OK, thank you very much. Well, thank you to the panel members. You've raised a number of interesting points, which I'm sure my colleagues will want to explore. So let me hand over to Fiona Hislop. Thank you.
Good morning, and thank you all for joining us. I would like to come to Robbie, then Pam, then Jane. Robbie, you mentioned the National Planning Framework 4, and obviously the draft that we have will place a number of new net zero related commitments on developers and planning authorities. So I'd be interested to find out from you if you think the profession itself is prepared for such changes, if what needs to happen, and what do you think planners should be doing to help deliver net zero? To Robbie, please.
Thank you. Thanks for that question. Scottish Government last year, when they published the position statement, did go on record saying that the MPF4 would radically address climate change. And in many regards, if we get this important stage of the consultation process right, this could be the case. To do so, fundamentally, we need an effective consenting process, and we have concerns, as do a number of stakeholders, over the clarity of the framework. And that's in terms of the wording for the decision maker, but also in terms of the clarity of process. For example, the policy relating to zero waste mentions the use of decarbonisation strategies, but then no more information on what they are and how they be assessed. So there is a number of additional duties and assessments coming through, and some of these will be beneficial, I think, in achieving net zero, for example, the carbon life cycle assessment. But to support planners to be able to process planning applications, to be able to deal with these assessments, we need to set out guidance on how they do that, set out clear frameworks for applicants and how they submit that kind of information. But then, sort of thinking more broadly about, well, how should planning address net zero? Fundamentally, planning is a tool for local government in delivering that kind of place-based approach to decarbonisation, but also climate change adaptation as well. And this really needs driven by a robust evidence base, which looks at climate change mitigation, adaptation, but also carbon reduction targets as well. And then through that plan making, through front loading that kind of evidence base, planners can identify the infrastructure needs, allocate the right sites for development, and provide that kind of strategic framework to achieve net zero ambitions. Touching on the previous question as well, I think there's a really important role here for the Scottish Government's digital planning strategy. So that's seen a significant investment, £35 million over the next 5 years. A number of efficiencies could potentially be derived from this strategy, and hopefully it could also support planners when they're building evidence bases to support the preparation of local development plans. But also, so once we establish the evidence base, then planning can determine the location, the scale, the mix, the character of development, and ensure that the density and the layout, the building orientation and landscaping can reduce carbon dioxide emissions, but also make developments more resilient to climate impacts. Planning can encourage a wide range of behavioural change, for example, encouraging people to travel by active travel through creating walkable green neighbourhoods, and I guess the premise behind the 20-minute neighbourhood policy that we see in the MPF4. But also at development management, planning can ensure that the right low-carbon technology is delivered in the right place, so consenting renewable developments, but also restricting fossil fuel extraction, for example, but really supporting this kind of green industrial revolution. And I think that's something you can really see coming through if you look at the national developments which are being promoted in the draft MPF4, which certainly have that kind of green growth theme running through them. But just equally, net zero ambitions and climate change adaptations do have tensions between them as well. So you think, for example, the need to reduce travel by private cars, connecting to existing heat networks and avoiding flood risk areas are all things we need to do on this journey to net zero. But some of them might conflict and contrast and often need taken in a case-by-case basis. And that's a really important role that development management plays. And I think most importantly, planning is about seeking those kind of magical moments in which action on climate mitigation and adaptation also delivers a wide range of other benefits, for example, health and well-being or tackling inequality. As we know, some of the most vulnerable people in society are going to be affected by climate change the most. So I'll stop there.
That was very comprehensive in terms of your view on MPF4 and what we need to do. Can I just ask about the profession itself? Are you saying they just need the right evidence, the guidance, etc.? Do they need to change the change and develop themselves as a profession? Are you saying there's no upskilling required for net zero for existing planners, that they could just hit the ground running now, or will they need to professionally develop, do you think?
I'd say partially. I think for a long time planners have worked with sustainable development since the early 90s, to be honest, so it's nothing new in terms of that. I think now we have a stronger central policy framework, which will allow planners the confidence to, for example, refuse development that is not in line with net zero ambitions. But there is going to be definitely some upskilling in terms of sort of climate literacy, and I sort of will refer back to the carbon life cycle assessments, and that is a new assessment coming through, and we will have to upskill planners to be able to handle that. We might not have to look that far. Those kind of frameworks and processes are available elsewhere, for example, in London. Okay.
Thank you. And I'll move on to Pam. You talked about the importance and need for a delivery plan for the draft NPF4, and it's not there. What would you like to see in that delivery plan?
Thank you, Deputy Convener. I mean, I think just coming on to that, just to set the context for the delivery plan, some upskilling is needed for planning and related professionals do it, the skills there to do it, tools there. Plan really comes to the tools. There's two things. You can have the people with the skills, but you need the tools to be able to effect the policies and actually make the intentions of national policies happen. So fundamentally, we need two things. We need very strong, robust, clear and deliverable national policies. And we still have some way to go and draft NPF4 to ensure these policies are robust and deliverable. The delivery plan, what we would like to see is that it doesn't just address placemaking, and it doesn't just address the national developments that are set out in the draft NPF4. We would like it to look at the capital and the revenue funding that is required to deliver the intentions of those policies. A net zero and the wider climate change agenda is a fundamentally important part of NPF4, and rightly so. But what we must have in that tool and that key policy document is not policies that say must and should, but policies that actually require change, that one must do something rather than should. And the wording of that is very, very important when you're a planning officer sitting with a planning application in front of you and having that dialogue with the developer that's proposing that development. So that strength of national policy is very, very important. So we would want the delivery plan to cover both capital and revenue. We've touched on some of the revenue policies today. I think we would also want to see, heads of planning would also want to see what we call a spatial expression of energy. You know, the energy plan actually set out spatially. There's lots of different documents coming forward looking at local heat energy systems, looking at wind energy, etc. But what we need is a comprehensive energy plan spatially to see this is what can be achieved in Scotland to help that planning process. And I think all of these things would give us a much more solid footing. Heads of planning have very much welcomed draft NPF4. It's a good document, but we do think there's some way to go to bring the delivery plan forward and more concise and deliverable policies.
Thank you, Pam. Can I just go back a bit to the people aspect and what the impact would be of the shortfall in planners and also funding on the ability of planning authorities to help deliver net zero commitments? And also, planners will become a premium, and not just obviously in the public sector, but in the private sector. Is there a potential for a brain drain of planners from the public sector to the private sector as the private sector themselves are trying to do more in the area of net zero?
It's happening now. So there is a shortage of planners, particularly in some of our rural local authorities. They're finding it particularly challenging to recruit. As part of the Future Planners project that both Robbie Calvert and I have touched on, which is currently ongoing, we're undertaking a refund also with the Young Planners Network and getting a very positive response to that. So we're currently just analysing those returns just now. So it is really hard to recruit into the public sector just now, not just local authorities. That is very challenging. And until there is some changes brought into place, and we haven't defined what those changes are, Robbie's touched on apprenticeships, We need to promote the career. We need to promote planning as a fundamentally important career as part of the green agenda in Scotland. And
thank you. I'm not sure if you've finished. You've frozen.
Can you hear me okay?
It's breaking up slightly. Carry on.
Okay, apologies for that. I was saying that we need to promote the planning profession as part of the green agenda, which is a fundamental part of.
Okay, thank you very much, Pam. And then finally, to Jane, if you can comment on draft MPF 4 and your views, and particularly that role of planners. And do you think this young generation of planners see themselves as leaders within local authorities on net zero?
I think we do. I think the university courses are changing sort of year on year to keep up to what we need to do. And I have recently did a round table on the MPF 4 where we had a student along, and I asked the question, do you feel that the universities are gearing you up properly for this in terms of the skills? And there's a lot of practical kind of elements being brought into the courses. And as planners, we need to sort of fulfil 50 hours of CPD, continuous professional development, every 2 years as part of our chartered membership, or just to make that. As well as that, I think generally the people that are in planning do want to upskill, do want to get on top of what they need to get on top of in order to be able to carry out their job. It's crucial. And when you think of like development management planners, where you've got maybe 30, 40, possibly more applications to your name, maybe enforcement cases to deal with, pre-application inquiries to deal with, and maybe other things on the side, you are working and trying to build up those skills at the same time. Now, maybe if we were like better resourced in terms of numbers, if you had 20 planning applications to your name, you could definitely do a lot more in terms of getting that skills more embedded, maybe more quickly. You could work in a more mentoring system. Maybe people would have time for that. Whereas the job itself, I've worked in development management, and it's a conveyor belt you're on, and you're always learning new things every day. But I think sometimes you need a wee bit of time just to bed in some knowledge, which maybe you don't always get when you're under the course.
OK, thank you very much, all of you, indeed. And I'll pass back to the convener.
Thanks very much, Fiona. I think Monica Lennon has a supplemental in this area. Monica, over to you.
Thank you, convener. Good morning to our panel. Yeah, just when I was listening to the answers to the deputy convener's questions, Robbie, you were right to say that this is not new to planners, and planners have been working with sustainable development since the early 90s. I just wondered, in terms of the weight that is given to issues relating to the climate and to nature, is sufficient weight being given to the net zero agenda, or is it the case that planners are being expected to take all things into account and try and be all things to all people, but we're still not getting that clear emphasis? So I just wondered, in terms of, I suppose, as a development management point of view, in terms of that pecking order of material considerations, where does net zero sit day to day for most planners? Maybe come to Robbie and then Pam on that, please.
Thanks, Monica. Yeah, really good question. There is, if we're thinking about the draft MPF4, there is some issues in terms of how the decision maker will use the document, and especially in terms of prioritisation. The climate emergency policy and the nature emergency policy are both sat within the universal policy section, so the first section of the national planning policy area of the MPF4. So they're to be applied to all planning applications, but as set out by Scottish Government, all relevant policies are to be applied in the decision-making process. So I think a number of stakeholders are a bit concerned there about how the planner will prioritise, for example, climate and nature against economic development or other policy considerations. It does drill down a little bit into this, well, the devil's in the detail. For example, in the climate emergency policy, it does say that significant weight needs applied to the, or should be applied to the climate emergency in determining applications. I think, as far as I'm aware, it's the only time significance used in the document. So there is a steer there for planners to give extra weight to that in the process. And whether that's clear enough, helpful enough for the decision maker, that's contended at the moment. That's contentious at the moment.
Thank you, Robbie. Pam and next, Pam, please.
Thank you. I think my camera has been turned off because a few connection problems. Absolutely. I mean, we have sustainability policies currently across Scotland in our local development plans. But what we really need to see, as Robbie Calvert has highlighted, is a real strengthening of the policies that are proposed in National Planning Framework 4. I referred in a previous answer to not having policies that say should or could, but actually requiring and the musts and that type of policy language will be really important. And it's that fundamentally step change that we need. So planners already absolutely have climate change and net zero. It's kind of ingrained almost in how one works and a lot of the policies that are set out just now. But what we're really asking of the planning system, and not just the planning system, it's not just local government, it's national government, it's the key agencies all working together, is that fundamental step change if we are to achieve the net zero targets.
Thank you. And Jane, I wonder if you would like to add to that. I guess working on the front line of planning, you're very familiar with sort of pushback from applicants when they look at all the policies, we say, but this will create extra jobs, or we can't afford to put this into the scheme. So is there a lot of pressure on planners to maybe sometimes let things slide?
Thanks. I think that is just the nature of sort of development management and somebody putting forward a development. The policy is there and should be providing certainty for one side and clarity for the other. But there will always be, and you only need to look at the likes of planning law to understand how a particular point can be argued in both directions. And I think to a point that's perfectly acceptable because you've got the public interest and sort of vested interest in terms of the private sector. And planning is about finding that balance, is about looking at everything in a detail and then in the round. So that is part of a development manager's job, is to do that. But the wording of the policy, etc., is really crucial in being able to draw a line and try and achieve these sort of net zero targets and different things that have been asked of us now.
Thank you.
Thanks very much, Monica. Next up, Mark Ruskell, to be followed by Liam Kerr. Mark, over to you, please.
Thanks. I had a number of quite specific areas just to ask you about. So the first one was full cost recovery. For those management functions, and you know, given the funding difficulties that planning departments have at the moment, where you see full cost recovery sitting, and how you think that can be delivered equitably between minor applications and major applications. Could I perhaps start with Pam with that one, please?
Certainly, yeah. And thank you for the question. Firstly, heads of planning welcome the recently published increase in national statutory fees for planning, and largely those commence on the 1st of April this year. But heads of planning have been seeking full cost recovery for some time now, and we continue to have those discussions with Scottish Government colleagues. We're currently really looking at how the full cost recovery should be defined. And certainly heads of planning are very keen to explore that is well beyond planning application work itself. So when you get a planning application for, say, a wind farm, as an example, there are many people who are involved in that, not just the planning officer themselves, who's leading that application. And it's really important that that full cost recovery considers that. It's also that planning authorities are not funded. Local government isn't funded to bring forward a local development plan, which is a considerable piece of work, often in the region of £500,000 to fund that piece of work, as well as planning enforcement and other areas. So part of the conversation we're having just now with government is what is full cost recovery, and we certainly hope that the outcome of that will be a wider scope.
Okay, thanks. Can I bring in Robbie?
Yes, thanks. Just to kind of reiterate some of the things Pam said there, and I think that's I know the HOPS work in 2018 had cost recovery set at about 66% in terms of core application processing costs, and we would definitely support that to move towards 100%. We'll see whether the fee increase does that, although there is varying control across planning authorities in terms of how fee income is reinvested into the service. And that's something that will vary. But just to stress her point made on local development planning, and I think, unfortunately, that's one of the areas that might suffer in a resource-deficient environment, is a lot of that kind of place vision and that kind of creative work needed to sort of set out the framework for net zero, if planning authorities are just sort of treading water, undertaking the statutory functions and really focusing on development management. We have additional concerns there. There's alongside the draft MPF4 consultation, there's a local development plan, the draft local development plan regulations and guidance, and within that there's a lot of additional work there that we're concerned about for development planning teams. And I think that's twinned with potential concerns that increases in planning application fees will be simply reinvested into the development management service. And so we might have acute resourcing issues in development planning teams specifically.
Yeah, and that engagement work with LDPs is so critical to then getting the right development applications later on.
Absolutely. And meaningful community engagement is expensive.
Yeah. Jane, do you have anything you'd like to add to those points?
Thanks. I would only really echo what Robbie and Pam has said. And I think in terms of the talk about cost recovery, obviously, the development planning side has been brought up there, that does need to be supported, etc. But I would also say that I think we have to be mindful of what development management is, and that is it's a service, it's a customer service. People are paying fees to get their planning applications determined. There's also the statutory timescales in which to determine them. And there's the fact that the authorities are measured on that performance as well. So, again, going back to the point of having 30, 40 planning applications to your name as your caseload, along with other things, the question is, how much quality can you build into every single one of your applications when you're in that position? And how much of in terms of investment from the private sector side, house builders, etc., you know, that customer service is important. You won't return to a restaurant if you don't get served properly, you know. So I think we've got to be mindful of the whole system and what it's trying to achieve on the ground.
Yeah, thanks. Can I move on to another area, which is permitted development, and whether you have views about how or if permitted development rights should be extended in certain areas, and how you see that then relating to policies to protect the historic environment. I get a lot of constituents getting in touch, or maybe in conservation areas, who, you know, are struggling with, you know, decisions around whether it should be 3 or 6 millimetre thick double glazing on, you know, issues about astragals and windows and everything else, and they feel that, you know, if they're to upgrade their homes, then it can be a bit of a minefield in terms of getting planning approval in historic areas. So I wonder if you have thoughts about particular categories of permitted development and also where we draw the line in terms of protection of the historic environment. Hey, those are two big areas. But can I start with Robbie, just general thoughts on that?
Yes, I think, well, firstly, for your constituents, I just want to flag the service provided by Planning Aid Scotland. So they provide a free and partial planning advice service. That's something I volunteer for and regularly take cases for. So I think there's definitely a point there in supporting people to navigate through the system. And I think we need to look at the draft MPF4 in regards to that as well. This is a document that the public are going to have to engage with. So be careful there's not too much jargon there and it's not inaccessible. That's especially considering that members of the public might also have to read the draft MPF4 alongside local development plans and potentially local place plans as well. In terms of permitted development rights, we advocate that we cautiously explore their use. You know, you look down in England and there's been some difficulties with permitted development rights, for example, with office to residential conversions. And so these have circumvented the planning system to some degree and has led to very poor quality accommodation being delivered. So, you know, some concern there. But in terms of if we can take out some of the more non-contentious applications out of the system and allow planners to focus on the bigger, more important applications, then I think we would broadly support that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and Jane?
I don't know if Pam wants to comment on.
Jane, do you have any thoughts on that?
Thanks. I would just echo what Robbie said there, that the permitted development rights, you could debate that for quite a while, and I would think caution would be right, particularly around certain things. It depends on what sort of sector you're talking about in terms of those permitted development rights, because there's householder permitted development rights, there's telecoms permitted development rights. For example, the telecoms permitted development rights are slightly more restrictive in the likes of a national park, because obviously they've got landscape concerns. I think we would all support landscapes being protected in a national park, so we've got somewhere nice to go and sort of good for tourism, etc. So it depends on where you want to talk and exactly where you want to talk about it.
I mean, I think the context here is very much the decisions that local authorities are having to make around energy efficiency improvements or, you know, installation of solar panels on roofs or whatever, and those type of household developments, or EV charging points, or whatever sort of infrastructure that is important.
Yeah, I would just add that when we talk about protections and you spoke about the historic environment, I'm not quite sure where you would draw that line, because we do want to protect our historic environment, but we do also need to be getting in around these sort of net zero ambitions. It's hard to know where to draw that line, but it could be debated for probably a number of days.
Thanks. And Pam?
Yes, thank you. In relation to the built heritage in terms of permitted development rights, Heads of Planning wouldn't support increasing those permitted developments where you have designated areas, whether that's conservation areas or properties that are listed. Those designations are there for a purpose. The enhancement of those areas and properties are maintained. So it's important that the permitted development rights are removed in many of those areas and instances. Beyond that, in our wider urban areas, then yes, I think there is scope to look at some minor development, and some of that could be energy related. And you know, you give a good point, a good example in terms of the charging points and how they might roll out. So Heads of Planning is very happy to look at those aspects of potentially additional permitted development. And that actually is an ongoing conversation with colleagues in Scottish Government.
Mm-hmm. Okay, my last question then was around, you know, effectively, where are decisions made? Where is it appropriate to make decisions? And I think, Robbie, earlier on, you were talking about some of the challenges that departments have, particularly the loss of senior managers and specialists, maybe around visual impact, ecology, whatever. So in terms of renewables development, is the current boundary between determination at local authority planning department level and determination at national government level the right, drawn at the right threshold? So I'm talking about Section 36 applications here. I'm aware that some councils may be in a situation where they get a hydropower scheme with an enormous environmental impact assessment, hugely technical, huge amount of ecology required around that hydrological assessments, and that might end up on the desk of a relatively junior planning officer. So are those sort of issues live, and is the right kind of level for determination set through Section 36 at the moment or not?
So I think it's was it currently set at 50 megawatts, I believe, above that, the Section 36. But then the planning authority is obviously a consultee. I think from the perspective of planning authorities, and I think Pam will be able to support this point, but I believe it's about 50% of the application fee goes to them. And I think that is contended a wee bit because, like as you say, a lot of planning authorities effectively have to almost determine the planning application afresh, even if they are the consultees, and undertake a lot of quite resource-intensive community engagement-type work as well alongside that. So, you know, that much-needed resource has to come into the planning system to support, you know, programmes of upskilling and ensuring that the officers have the right expertise to deal with some of these assessments. I think another really important part of that puzzle is some of the other professional services within local authorities, for example, landscape officers. So, you know, ensuring that you have enough of them because they're a really important part of determining onshore wind. And so providing that internal expertise to the planning officer in a reasonable time frame is another important part of achieving decisions in a good time frame.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Pam.
Yes, thank you. And just building on what Robbie has just outlined, I mean, yes, I think the Section 36 fees could be looked at again to look at, you know, what's the proportion local authorities get. And I think it's in those instances where planning authorities aren't just sitting on their own. Heads of planning provides a really good network, and people do reach out if they've got a particular question or has somebody dealt with X, Y, or Z, and that knowledge and expertise is shared. And it will tend to be planners with more experience that will deal with these types of applications. So a number of planning authorities will have planners with experience in terms of energy applications and energy consents.
Okay, thanks. Jane, I don't know if you want to add anything.
No, I think Rogie and Pam covered it
once. Great, thanks. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Mark. Next up is Liam Kerr, to be followed by Jackie Dunbar. Liam, over to you.
Thank you, Convener. I'll direct a question to Jane Tennant specifically at first. Jane, you talked in your opening remarks about finding out about planning and the fact that you'd find it as a new career. So can you help the committee understand what options and support are available for those who do wish to change career and work in planning, and what could be done to encourage more people to make such a move?
Thanks. I don't really know, in a sense. I came back to I found planning through environmental management course. I took up environmental management because everything was kind of going environmental at that time, and I thought there had to be like a skill set, and it was a well-rounded course in terms of its like social, sort of physical, like the renewable side of things, economics. So it attracted me in that way. I've recently been speaking to some geography students, which is a very logical sort of step to come out of that and go into sort of planning or a related sort of specialism. And I think it's just trying to make sure that one, people are aware of it as a career, and what exactly is involved in it, because I think sometimes maybe only people think of it as being people that come round and sort of deal with your house extension or whatever, if your mum and dad had had an extension, or if your parents have been in like planning or architecture or something, that seems to be how people are aware of it. So I think there needs to be more in geography courses in school pointing towards planning as a career, and let it follow through from there, because it's schools and that kind of level before you start to go to university where you make up your mind of what you're kind of trying to do or think what you could do.
Thanks very much. Sticking with skills, I'll direct a question to Robbie Calvert, please. Robbie, in your opening comments, you said that something about in England you can do a planning apprenticeship, but that such an apprenticeship wouldn't be available yet in Scotland. Can you help the committee understand why is that? Why is that difference there? And you also talked about some work you're doing to bring an apprenticeship to Scotland. So when does that conclude? When will that come to a decision on whether it will happen or not? And in whose gift is it to bring it in?
So I will work back on your questions there. So the work that we're doing alongside Heads Planning Scotland Improvement Service, called the Future Planners Project that Pam also discussed, that's due for publication May, June. In terms of the apprenticeship, I think there's an issue in particular that the skills development, I think it's a numbers issue, really. So in England, there's obviously a larger population, so a significant extra requirement in terms of planners than there is here. And so there's a kind of threshold in terms of numbers of people who would go through an apprenticeship scheme per year that Skills Development Scotland won't really assess it as an individual option for an apprenticeship. There is an opportunity to have planning alongside other built environment areas as part of a sort of joined up kind of apprenticeship approach, built environment one. But to run an individual one, I think they need at least 100 per year, which is above what we would need as a profession or be able to probably maintain in terms of an apprenticeship scheme. So I think there's definitely an issue in terms of numbers. And as I said, compared to other sectors, the number is relatively small in terms of additional entrants that we need. But the position of planning is absolutely vital in terms of net zero. So it's not a huge amount of numbers, but it'll have a massive impact in terms of whether we can achieve net zero or not.
Thanks for that. I think that's a fair point to make. And if I might stick with you, Robbie Calvert, but Pam and Jane come in if there's something that they wish to add. But it sounds like demand for planners is going to be huge and vitally important, as you say. Are you aware, Robbie Calvert, of what impact local authority funding settlements from the Scottish Government has had on places to train for these skills, and also the local authority's ability to afford to hire more planners? And do you get any sense yet on what this year's settlement, which I think COSLA said was £100 million cut to local authority budgets, might have on those places to study and the local authority's ability to hire the planners that they might need?
Yeah, I think this goes back to what kind of support we provide in terms of education, planning education. There is a limited run of, for example, bursaries. I know the Jim Boyack Trust, for example, have a small amount of funding each year. But that's something that could certainly be expanded. And I know in the past, many senior planners now were paid to study planning many, many years ago. So we could look again at that. In terms of budgets for local authorities, I think Pam might be a better set to answer that. Again, it will vary across planning departments, across local authorities, how much is invested into their planning service. I know quite a few planning authorities have had significant recruitment drives recently. I also note the kind of base wage has gone up, the salaries increased, so maybe that's indicative of a shortage of planners entering the sector as well. I think Pam wants to come in now.
Yeah, very grateful. Pam, would you like to add to that?
Yes, thank you. I mean, there are real challenges that we've talked about hiring, you know, actually recruiting and planners and planning authorities, and we've touched on many of those. And it really starts with getting more people into the profession, whether that's at undergraduate level, but also postgraduate level, which may be a quicker route where people are interested in coming into the profession. The impact on funding has been considerable, particularly over the past decades. And services such as planning services have been, and heads of planning view, particularly affected by previous settlements. The statutory planning fees is the main income for planning authorities. And as I've touched on, we welcome the recent increase that's about to be implemented from the 1st of April. But that only goes some way. And I would stress that fees isn't the total answer to how you properly resource a planning authority. So we would like to see other consideration given into how does that funding come into planning authorities directly to assist in delivering the skills that are required and delivering the number of people that's required to, in order that we can achieve the Scottish Government's intentions that will be laid out in National Planning 4 and other key documents.
I'm very grateful. Convener, unless Jane has anything to add, I shall hand back to you.
No, I don't think so, no.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Liam, let me hand over to Jackie Dunbar, and I'll then pass, after Jackie, pass over to Monica Lennon. Jackie, over to you.
Good morning, panel. If I can just follow up on a couple of things that you've already touched on. I think, Jane, you've been speaking about planning as a career, and I think you just mentioned that education in schools, we should be trying to ensure that our pupils are aware of planning being a career. Is there anything more that schools can do to ensure that this can happen? Because I know you still get career days and everything, but I'm sure when you're in S3, for example, it might not be top of your mind to become a planner. So what could the schools do to try and encourage our young folk to come forward?
Thanks. I'm a long time out of school myself, so I can't say I'll be reflecting too well on it. But I think, yeah, I take my opportunities with careers days. And I think just generally, that, like, if you do a geography course, for example, and you really enjoy geography, maybe your careers advisor or your teacher is maybe going to push you towards doing a geography degree, coming out and doing being a geography teacher. There is a lot more jobs that can come out the back of a geography degree. It would be planning, other specialisms, potentially the people need to go on and do a master's or whatever. But I think it's also just about being able to tune in to what your subject can offer in terms of jobs and being able to explain that to pupils about, so if you have a pupil that's interested in your course, and this is for any career sort of thing, that they point you towards all the possible options of that interest and where you could go in life. And I think that's really important. And I don't think it wasn't the case for me. I know I spoke to someone who's came up 10 years behind me. It wasn't the case for them. So I think there just needs to be a wee bit more thinking about how a hire or whatever translates into a potential career. If that person's interested in that course.
That's grand. I think we, by what you're saying, we need our planning department to step across the corridor to speak to our education department and local authorities to plug your department for you. I think it was Robbie we heard from earlier, convener, about the skill sets needing to be in the right places. And about growing your, well, I was going to ask him if growing your own in the local authorities is doable, especially with, you know, if we can get the apprenticeships stuff off the ground. I know my own local authority grows our own environmental officer, so I'm not sure, but is that something that local authorities could bring forward?
Yes, that's what we're seeing down in England anyway with the apprenticeship scheme there. So in terms of the kind of educational component, that can be about one day a week, kind of day release type thing, and then over a number of years. So, I think the grow your own approach would be very useful. I think in particular for a lot of rural planning authorities that are quite far away from some of the planning schools, which are predominantly in the Central Belt or Dundee. So you can imagine up in Shetlands or Orkney, for example, where they do have trouble hiring graduate planners, that grow your own approach can be very useful. I think there's it's also about bringing more diversity into the profession as well. So ensuring that we have children from lower income backgrounds and potentially not going to go through the university route and pulling them into the profession through the apprenticeship scheme. So I think we could improve the diversity of the profession in the long run as well. And just to briefly touch on your previous question as well, I think there's a wider point about educating younger people in terms of planning, because it's also about civic participation as well. And we know in the planning system, young people aren't getting involved in the consultation process, engaging with applications. And I think there's a broader point there about educating young people on planning and placemaking considerations, and really mobilising the kind of school strike, young green movement into professional roles where they can make a difference throughout their career.
Okay. And Pam, you spoke earlier about local authorities sharing expertise and best practice. Can you maybe explain briefly what arrangements are currently in place for this, and what could be done to improve the best practice of sharing with other local authorities?
Thank you. Yes, I mean, we have a very strong network across Heads of Planning Scotland, and that continually gets built upon. So if somebody, for instance, receives an application and they think we don't have a particular expertise, or we have a whole range of questions in this, then there is mechanisms there for them to draw on that. I guess the reality is our profession is quite small in Scotland, and there is a good network already within that. And that builds on training as well. RTPI Scotland, Royal Town Planning Institute, whole chapter. They have a chapter network that is called, and events are held. And all of these things are really important in terms of building, particularly young people coming into their year, people at the start of their career, building their networks. But planning really needs to be seen as part of the construction sector, part of the green economy, and raising the awareness in the sector. I think a mention was made to, we need to go and chap the doors of our education colleagues. I actually think some of this sits with the Scottish Government. Heads of Planning, as part of the Future Planning Project, are really raising this in terms of, within the Scottish Government, what can be done across directorates to get that recognition of the profession as part of the STEM programme within schools, and how is that built in? And there's also a role in terms of positive publicity. And that's not just for planning authorities, it's for lots of people, including elected members, both at a local level and a national level, of how do we actually celebrate better the fantastic places that are getting shaped and built out across Scotland, and what's been achieved with planning and planners at the heart of that. So I think there is much to do. But through the Future Planners Project, we are looking at the things that have been raised, including the sharing of expertise, how do we build on that? We're looking at what could be done to create more short-term opportunities, for people to come in and get some experience as well. So there's a wide range of actions being taken.
Thank you. And if I could just ask one last question, and I'm not sure who would be best to answer, convener, so whoever thinks is best, if you can just shout out. We saw through the COVID-19 that some decisions were being made and things were being put in place in super quick time. So what lessons can we learn from this going forward as we try and reduce our greenhouse gas emissions? I'm not sure who would be best placed.
I'm happy to come in on that, convener. Lots of things had to change super quick as we all started to change the way we were working and adapt systems when the pandemic came along. Planning authorities have reflected on that, and they've reflected it annually. We prepare a planning performance framework, and we've reflected that over the past 2 years of those, and what are the lessons learnt, and actually what are the positives out of that in terms of driving forward improvements. I think there has been a lot of improvement in terms of the digital capability of the system, and Scottish Government are taking forward a digital programme to enhance that further over the coming years. So that will be important in terms of that. I think those are the key changes and the key lessons to be learnt. It's about how can we have technology that will assist us to make the job of the planner easier in terms of process and not have a cumbersome process. But I would highlight that, you know, when we think back a decade ago, heads of planning discussion then was we need a simplified and a streamlined planning system. And we actually have moved well away from that, and we have a much more complex planning system, and we can't really see that reducing. So that complexity takes time to work through a planning application, or takes time to develop a local development plan or be part of delivering a project. So planning has got more complex. I think it's important to recognise that. And it really comes down to the strength of policies. So we can deliver quicker and we can deliver better if our national policies are clear, concise and deliverable. The submissions that we receive are of a very good quality from day. Our communities have been engaged at an early stage as well, and communities feel involved and many of these applications coming forward.
Thank you very much. I have no other questions, convener. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much, Jackie. Monica Lennon has the final set of questions. Monica, over to you, please.
Thank you, convener. This has been a really interesting session. I say that as a former young planner, a former planner, but it's great to be talking about the future of planning today. And it's no surprise that I believe that planning jobs are the ultimate green jobs, and I do believe we need more visibility for the profession and all the opportunities there are for planners. Going back to the point about routes into the profession and university, I'm old enough to say that I studied planning in the late 90s at the University of Strathclyde, and that's no longer an option for planners. So we've got two universities in Scotland where you can go as an undergraduate, Dundee and Heriot Watt. Thinking about what Robbie has said about being more diverse and thinking about people from perhaps more working class backgrounds, I know that when I go to schools, you know, lots of young people want to talk about planning, even if they don't maybe know what the planning profession is, but they know that planning is all around them. And this generation is more aware and more passionate about environmental, social and economic justice. So what would I say to young people in central Scotland, for example, who can't afford to move away to Dundee or can't even travel to Heriot Watt because public transport is very expensive in this country? What other routes are available to them right now? And do we have enough planning schools in Scotland? Maybe start with Jane and then come to Pam.
Thank you. We've touched on the course I did and a course I've recently interacted with, which was a geography, the Geography Society at the University of Glasgow. So there's like the environmental management course at Glasgow Caledonian University that offers planning content as well as like SEA work, EIA work, that kind of side of things. So it's good broad brush. There are most likely other courses out there beyond geography at University of Glasgow and the course I did at the Cali. But these courses can feed into it. And there is also, you can like find yourself a sort of relative planning role. I don't know much about it, but there is the associate route within the RTPI that you still end up becoming chartered. There's potentially a forthcoming sort of apprenticeship thing. But if you're in an environment management course or GIS or you know, geography sort of based things. These are easy, I see them as easy feeders in, because you've already kind of built up a lot of the skill sets and general knowledge about the built and natural environment. So these are feeder courses into that. It doesn't, I didn't do a town planning undergraduate, I did a town planning master's. And that was the route that I saw, was just coming through that clear 2-year APC with an accredited degree. But there is the associate route, and there are other courses that kind of give you that foundation of knowledge, I guess.
Thank you, Jane. Pam, then Robbie.
Thank you for your support for the profession. It's very much welcomed. Some of this has really been looked at through the Future Planner study that we're really getting our teeth into just now. And that's, let's not, we've recognised we've got too much of a dependence on people coming from school into university and coming into a planning authority. So we're really looking to how do we widen those pathways, get different pathways, so we can take people from school, give them some work experience, how do we link it into colleges and get those different networks and pathways coming through. It's not just planners with a degree in planning and then a member of the Royal Town Planning Institute that work in a planning authorities. That will be the predominant resource in a planning authority. But there are a role for technicians, there are a role for other professionals working alongside. And I think when we look at the net zero agenda and overall climate change, it's how do we get all of those complementary professionals working together? And in the context of the discussion this morning, supporting the planners in terms of delivering and whether it's application, local development plans or projects. But fundamentally, we need some shifts for this to make it happen. I mean, I found it hugely interesting to be involved in the Future Planners project. But there are so many different funding streams, but none of them are really jumping out at here's a route for planning. And yet planning sits in STEM. Planning is part of the construction sector. So I think part of it is we need to reprofile the profession and the need for that and moving forward. But we also need to look at the funding streams that can come in to help planning authorities bring those individuals directly from school, actually have the funding to provide those, whether it be through internships, through university or school placements, or actually having the ability to have a member of staff or members of staff to give them the time to get out into schools, to reach out and to help young people just think through, you know, what is it they would like to do. So there's a whole range of things being looked at, but fundamentally, some of that will require additional revenue funding to local authorities.
Thank you, Pam. Robbie?
Just to address directly the question about what would you advise someone in the Central Belt now, just to flag again the Jim Boyack Memorial Trust, that is for students who maybe have financial hardships and there is some funding available for that. So that's maybe a more immediate approach, and agreeing with everything that Pam and Jane have said. But I think there's another opportunity in terms of community engagement and how we can, as planners, sort of bring the planning system into the eyes of young persons. And as part of my voluntary role as with Planning Aid Scotland, I did a bit of work at Culloden High School, which was around the Inch Junction upgrade up there. So we were firstly engaging young people about decisions on this big piece of transport infrastructure, which was quite interesting because it was getting their input was more away from the sort of private vehicle, because a lot of them were getting buses or walking to school, for example. But as a part of that, planners from Highland Council then also set out what the planning system was to maybe 300 high school children. So I think there's a good opportunity there going forward with how we do community engagement. And I know in the Planning Act, there's a lot more about engaging young persons. And I think we need to use that opportunity to promote it as a career as well. And I think also with local place plans, which we haven't really touched on today, but if we can involve younger people in that and increase that civic engagement, increase that involvement with the planning system, hopefully you can pull in more interested young people through that route as well.
Thank you, Robbie, and thank you for mentioning the Jim Boyack Memorial Trust. I was a trustee many years ago, and I'm glad it's still going from strength to strength. The last time I checked, I think the annual grant was around about £1,500, maybe just over £2,000. Is there an opportunity for that fund to be supported by the Scottish Government and other stakeholders? Does that already happen, or is it mostly made up of individual donations?
I don't think it is by Scottish Government. We would certainly welcome that. I mean, I know other professions, for example, I know this is slightly off topic, but dentistry, there is funding available for that education. As a part of that, the graduates then have to work for the NHS for a number of years. Could we establish a system like that, where graduate planners then work for a planning authority for a number of years? If we had that funding available centrally from Scottish Government, that would be very much welcomed.
No, that's really interesting. I think that's a point we could pursue, because I know previously we've asked Scottish Enterprise at this committee to define a green job, and they weren't able to do that. So if we could at least get planning given as an example of a green job, that could open some doors. Just a very final question. I know we're pushed for time. I'm trying to catch the convener's eye. But I wanted to ask about 20-minute neighbourhoods. If we think about previous generations of planners were able to say that they had helped to create new towns. Now, when we look at the challenges ahead and opportunities, we want to see planners really at the heart of creating 20-minute neighbourhoods, and that will involve, you know, working with what we already have in lots of cases. Is that a way to encourage people into planning, to motivate the current planning workforce? And what are the main opportunities and barriers around that? Perhaps come to Pam and then Jane and Robbie if there's time, convener. Very briefly, I'm getting the eye. Very briefly, panel. Pam.
I'll be quick. 20-minute neighbourhoods isn't a new concept, but it's very much very much central to the draft National Planning Framework 4 and is welcomed. I think there's challenges about how it's rolled out or in rural areas, and will more have an urban focus. But I think what you're really highlighting is the placemaking, the place-shaping part of the planning profession. And actually, we talk about planning and planners, and actually should we be talking about placemakers and place-shaping? And sometimes it's about the language. And actually, if we talk like that, we might actually engage more young people than we do than talking about going to study town and country planning.
Thank you, Pam, for that very good brief answer. Robbie.
Yeah, I'm totally agreeing with Pam there. I don't think 20-minute neighbourhoods are good, but I think it's a great opportunity to get across the value of planning and placemaking. I think especially after COVID, especially that focus that everyone has on their neighbourhoods, I think it's a great opportunity to seize that and say, well, look, this is what positive, proactive planning can do for areas. And and I think that could be a great opportunity within that to bring younger people into the profession as well. So, yeah, very much support the 20-minute neighbourhood and the Living Well locally as well, importantly.
Great. And the last word to the future of planning, Jane.
Thank you. I would just echo everything that Robbie and Pam have said. I think ultimately where people engage most is within the local area. If we can get like school kids and teenagers and stuff engaged in their local place through that 20-minute neighbourhood sort of concept, it is highly likely that it could get more people into planning as that is the bits click into place about how that sits within how the world comes to pass, really, and what happens on the ground.
Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you, Monica. And thank you to our panel for joining us this morning. We very much appreciate your insights into the challenges and the opportunities in the planning sector and beyond. That brings us to the end of our allocated time. The committee will have a private discussion of the evidence from this panel after we hear from our second panel. And I will briefly suspend the meeting for a setup of the next panel. Thank you once again. Well, welcome back, everyone. We now welcome our second panel. After focusing on the role of planning with our first panellists, we will now explore skills and vocational training. And to discuss this, I welcome our second panel, who are joining us remotely, Chris Brody, Director of Regional Skills, Planning and Sector Development, Skills Development Scotland, Jamie Brogan, Head of Climate Partnerships, Edinburgh Climate Change Institute, and Simon Hewitt, Principal, Dundee and Angus College, Lead Principal for Climate Emergency College Scotland. Thank you for joining us this morning. We have around 75 minutes for this panel, and we'll move straight on to questions. My first question, and you may, if you've been following some of the evidence given to committee in this area, we have heard that skills shortages within local authorities in key areas will limit the ability of local authorities to meet their net zero targets. I'd like to hear from the witnesses on whether you agree with those concerns. Is this something that you recognise? And if so, are there particular areas where the skill shortages are most acute? And what steps do you think are necessary from yourselves, from the Scottish Government, from Scottish Government agencies and from local governments themselves? What steps need to be taken to address those concerns and skills shortages? And perhaps I could start with Chris, then move on to Simon and then Jamie. So, Chris, over to you, please.
Great, thanks. And good morning to the committee, and thank you for the invitation to give evidence today. I think the point you make right at the introduction there about there being skill shortages right across the economy is absolutely right. We're facing significant labour shortage challenges at the moment due to a number of factors. Some of it is down to a very hot labour market, and part of that is resulting from the economic bounce back we've seen from COVID. Part of it is down to changes in terms of freedom of movement, which has impacted kind of in some sectors. I think a very underreported story is actually changes in the number of people who are available to work, and that's partly driven by demographics, it's partly driven by rises in economic inactivity. Now, all of that is important as context, because I think what it tells us is that there are challenges not just across local authorities, but right across the private sector at the moment. At the heart of the question is what we can do about that. And it will come as no surprise for me to say that I don't think there is a single silver bullet or simple answer to the multitude of challenges that we're facing. In Skills Development Scotland, one of the primary things we're doing is actually working with employers to understand where pinch points are. So we get active engagement right across a whole range of industry sectors. I think critically, we are looking at where there are opportunities to be aligning the £1.9 billion that we invest in education and skills behind economic opportunities and behind good jobs. I think that's going to be a critical component of what we do. I think more broadly, we need to look at steps we can take to grow Scotland's kind of labour force. So it is all very well having skills aligned to where skills requirements are, but we also need to get more people back into the workforce. And I think as well, we need to recognise that the economy and the labour market has been through a significant period of challenge as a result of COVID in particular. What that's thrown up is a lot of turmoil on the labour market. So I think we need a skill system and routes to training that include a big focus on upskilling and reskilling. I'll kind of pause there and realise I've given quite a general answer, but no doubt we'll pick up on some specifics as well.
Thanks very much, Chris. Now, that's a very good overview of the challenges you set out and some of the, I guess, unique factors at play in the labour market, given the exceptional couple of years we've just had. Simon, I'll pass over to you with the same question and then James.
Convener, and good morning. Just really to build on a few points that Chris made, I think it has been an extremely difficult 2 years for everyone within Scotland and beyond. I think throughout that time, colleges also have been challenged significantly, albeit the agility and the responsiveness of colleges throughout this period has been quite refreshing to see. I think from our point of view, in terms of the skills gaps, we're seeing skills gaps emerging, you know, right throughout this particular sector. I guess in terms of steps, one of the kind of key critical steps and one of the things that we have seen that has worked. One of the positives of the pandemic is how we have all kind of worked together for common aims and common good. And that's no difference, particularly within this sector. I know Robbie mentioned this morning, whilst given his evidence, Energy Skills Partnership, ESP, which is something that has been established really to bring industry partners together as well as Scottish colleges to really look hard actually at the skills needs, focusing hard on kind of wind and marine training, hydrogen training, advanced manufacturing training, etc. And really how we can work together to effectively plug the skills gaps that are there already. Colleges do play a vital role at this point. I think there's already excellent examples right across Scotland where there is already good work that's happening. But, you know, we are aware that there needs to be more done. But for more to do, you know, that will require more targeted, specific funding. That will require a real strategic intent, similar to like we've seen with the early learning childcare focus in 2019. But, you know, as a sector, we've got the infrastructure there, albeit needs investment. But I think the key step is really how we work collectively to try and address this.
Thank you very much, Simon. And Jamie, same question to you. Feel free to pick up on, you know, any particular issues that are most relevant to your work.
Yeah, thanks, convener. And there's several questions actually in what you asked. I mean, you're asking specifically about skill shortages in local authorities. I would agree with that statement and with Chris's observation that that's a shortage that we see across the wider economy. You asked about skills gaps. And we see both, this is not going to be a comprehensive assessment, but you see, we see both technical skills gaps and softer skills gaps. So the technical skills gaps are in areas like carbon accounting and climate finance that make sure that climate impact is embedded into all the decisions that we make. And the softer skills are more about behaviour change and enabling partnership building and stakeholder engagement. And you asked also, what do we need to do about it? I mean, part of that is just putting more people in with climate skills into roles of influence and driving change. But I think part of that is also, and Simon touched on it, building knowledge networks, thinking about where capacity and capability is best built, but not, you know, having to reinvent the wheel, sharing best practice, sharing knowledge networks across both the public and private sector. And there's a lot in that which we could unpick as the discussion unfolds.
Thank you very much. Thank you for those opening remarks. they were, I think, necessarily general in their nature because the question was quite wide. Let me focus on one of the key areas and bring it back to local authorities in terms of one of the key challenges local authorities will face in meeting net zero targets, and that's the heat in building strategy, which will require 200,000 homes a year to be retrofitted and installed with new heating systems, you know, by 2030, but with the work beginning in a few years' time. To put that into context, the current run rate for the installation of new heating systems is around 3,000 a year. So there's clearly going to have to be not an evolution, not an incremental change, but a kind of revolutionary step up in the number of buildings that will be retrofitted. Simple question, I mean, do we have anywhere near the number of qualified engineers and project teams that will be required to physically meet those targets? And I appreciate that might not be directly relevant to all of what you do on a day-to-day basis, but I would appreciate your views. Same order, I guess. Chris, then Simon, then Jimmy.
Great, thank you. It's a terrific question. I mean, just to put some kind of scale on the challenge. At the moment, we estimate there are something like 2,000 people just picking on decarbonisation and the installation of heat pumps as part of that challenge that you've outlined there. There are about 2,000 people in installation roles in the sector at the moment. That all of those individuals are not necessarily focused entirely on heat pumps. They'll also be focused on the fitting of kind of gas boilers. Some work that we did a couple of years ago suggested that there wasn't immediate skill shortages at this moment in time, but there is a looming challenge in terms of that rapid scale up. that you're describing that will need to take place in terms of heat pumps. It's not just around heat pumps, it's also around kind of thermal installation. And some of the estimates suggest that we could need to double or triple the workforce in a very short space of time. The challenge then becomes, how do you do that? And I think we are needing to look in two axes, at least two axes. One is about getting more people into these related trades, and that is absolutely part of the challenge. The biggest part of the challenge is going to be on reskilling the existing workforce as well. I think there's a third dimension to the challenge, which is the timing of the upscaling of investment around retrofit of housing and the installation of heat pumps, in that you will see a very large peak before the requirement begins to kind of stabilise in about 8 to 10 years' time, potentially. And that presents difficulties, I suppose, in terms of directing people into what might be perceived to be a relatively short-term kind of a short-term job or short-term activity. Say again, I think the challenge is ensuring that we've got the right upskilling and the right reskilling through our colleges and through our other training providers to meet that demand. Some of the work that we're doing at the moment is to try and move that away from the very national level and look specifically at what we need to put in place across different parts of Scotland. So we're currently working with Glasgow City Council on a piece of work to quantify not just what we think is going to be needed in the Glasgow City region, but to understand the extent to which that provision is in place or could be in place. Today, I had to cancel a visit to Borders College, where we were going down to have a very similar conversation about how we can build a programme of skills investment to support the programme of housing investment that's anticipated through housing associations in the South Region.
Thanks very much, Chris. That's really good context. I'm glad you were able to address that question directly, because it was quite specific. Just before I hand over to the others, you mentioned the need to potentially double or triple the workforce in this area, which will mean retraining or reskilling. But I would imagine retraining and reskilling will take possibly 2, 3, 4 years in some cases to achieve that level of skilling or training. Which means, I guess, that it needs to start now in order to for the work to begin in 2025, 2026, which means the corresponding scaling up of courses available, places available, needs to be kind of available now, or at least the next 12 months. Where are we now? I mean, in terms of that massive, significant upscaling of training required?
I'll ask Simon to come in and add a little bit of detail in a moment and his role in relation to the Energy Skills Partnership and also Colleges Scotland. He'll have a better handle on where some of the college system is at this moment in time. What I would say in relation to the comment you're making about upskilling and reskilling taking 2 to 3 years, I think the upskilling and reskilling period is much shorter than that, and we're looking at designing approaches and reskilling approaches that deliver in 12 weeks, 16 weeks, rather than 3 years. I think there's another component that we need to look at, and I know Simon is looking at this particular. Simon and colleagues are looking at this in the college sector. We're also looking at it in terms of apprenticeships. Is that the qualification frameworks that we teach need to reflect the skills of the future, not the skills of the 1990s or the early 2000s? So we've got an active programme of work looking at the components of our apprenticeship frameworks and our graduate apprenticeship frameworks, so that the qualifications catch up with where the market's heading.
Okay, thank you, Chris. That brings us neatly then to Simon. So, Simon, I appreciate your thoughts on this.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, again, just to echo Chris's points, very much this is something that is on the radar, and, you know, there is not a... We haven't started yet. We've most definitely started. The sector is already tackling this as part of the Construction Leads Forum through Energy Skills Partnership. There are already a number of colleges that are actively within this space that are already delivering upskilling and reskilling that's needed. And Chris is exactly right. You know, we recognise the scale of the challenge, and we recognise that shorter, sharper elements of upskilling and reskilling is the only way to tackle this, alongside other skills shortages. Curriculum needs to shift, it needs to change. it has shifted and changed to be much more focused. We are really pleased with how we've been working with other training providers, national bodies, as well as qualification agencies to ensure that qualifications are fit for purpose. So that's that upskilling and reskilling piece, quite clearly significant amount of work happening there. There's also, Chris touched on the apprenticeship piece, and as a college sector, we're the biggest delivery agent of apprenticeships in Scotland. We've around 11,000 apprentices year on year. So we know again that this is an area, so we need to inspire more people into these pathways. And you know, I picked up on the evidence this morning that there needs to be more information, guidance, support around what the careers are, what the pathways into these careers are, and how colleges, schools, universities can collectively work together alongside SDS and others to really help people understand the careers and pathways and the various different upskilling and reskilling opportunities that are there to get into these areas. So definitely a lot happening already, but we recognise that the pace does need to pick up. And that's where we're speaking to Scottish Government and others around specific funding to allow that to happen.
Thanks very much, Simon. That's very helpful. Before I hand over to Jamie, just to help the committee understand, I guess, the wider context and the trend in the number of places available, college places, university places, apprenticeships in this area, it'd be useful if you or the appropriate person could follow up in writing to the committee just to give us a sense of the trend over the last couple of years and the projected increase in the number of courses available over the next 2 or 3 years so that we can put that into some kind of context in hard numbers when we take a look at this issue in the round. Jamie, let me bring in you on the same question, if that's okay.
You answered it very well, actually. So I'm only going to pick up on one and emphasise one thing that you mentioned in there, which you need to match your labour market supply and demand at a more local level. It's something we're about to start trying to do with some of Simon's members, actually, and through the Edinburgh Climate Commission. Skills and labour supply is just one part of a very complex kind of system problem that is climate change. And you do need to think about, you do need to localise that supply and demand so that you're commensurate with your other elements of your climate challenge, like 20-minute neighbourhoods, like reducing our requirement on transport. If you don't match up your labour market with your point of service needs, then you're going to work against some of those things.
Thanks very much, Jamie. Let me bring in Fiona Hislop, who will follow up on some of the issues already raised. Fiona.
Good morning, everyone. I'll come to Jamie first, if that's okay. I'd like to ask Jamie, with your overview, is there a demand for reskilling and upskilling within local authorities? And I'd like to focus on local authorities in particular, because that's the point of our inquiry, local authorities and partners. Is there a demand for that? And are there any bottlenecks which might constrain this? And if there isn't sufficient demand, does it need to be stimulated to make sure that within local authorities, right across lots of different areas of staff and professions, that upskilling and reskilling happens? Jamie?
That's a complex question. I mean, is there demand? Yes, local authorities recognise the need to build their capability and capacity in this area, but they need to build capacity as well as capability. So they need to bring in more staff in order to have that demand, in order to then have the skills requirements. But they don't need to. The challenge for local authorities now is not just to rebuild a bigger sustainability team, it's to embed sustainability knowledge and net zero knowledge across it, of everything that they do. You know, and I could give you some numbers and some statistics on the importance and the role of local authorities and the control and influence they have over area-wide emissions. But yeah, there is absolutely the need there. But that need exists on all levels. You know, as I say, you need specialists, particular technical skills, but you also need that, go through that change process of embedding climate as a critical part of everything that a local authority does and is embedded in every decision it makes, from very senior level to operational level.
And how far are we on that journey? And in terms of, is it the same across all of Scotland that you can see, or are some local authorities stronger in doing this than others? Are there any good examples you might want to give us?
Well, we've worked closely with the City of Edinburgh, obviously, because that's where we're based, and we see ourselves as a kind of critical and responsible city partner. We've certainly lent our own knowledge and capacity actually to helping them to build theirs. They've been very good at drawing on the knowledge of the university and the Climate Institute to support their net zero ambitions and engage their city partners. So I would highlight them as an example of good practice, but they're not the only ones. You know, we're working with the Scottish Cities Alliance, who represent the seven Scottish cities and local authorities. And we've highlighted some specific areas, which I could go into. They are quite specific areas of where they need to build capability and capacity, and they recognise that. And we've made some recommendations which are actually currently sitting in the Scottish Government about how those are going to be implemented. And again, a point I raised in response to the last question, there is a question about where you should best build that capacity and whether you do it 7 times or 32 times across Scotland, or whether it's better done at a national level so that you're not reinventing the wheel across different local authorities.
Thank you. Before I move on to Chris Bodie, can I just ask you, Jamie, do you think there's more of a challenge for rural local authorities on this agenda of embedding climate change skills, upskilling, reskilling, whatever, you know, right across all aspects of local authority delivery?
Yes, is my short answer to that question.
Okay, thank you, Jamie. And if we can move on to Chris, clearly skills planning focuses on the anticipated needs of industry in order to deliver green jobs, but we are focusing particularly on local authorities and that transition to net zero society. So when you're doing your modelling, what have you done in relation to local authorities who are major employers apart from anything else? And obviously, as we know, very key to the delivery of net zero. So what assessment have you made of local authorities at staffing and professional needs for the transition?
Thank you for the question. You're right, our primary focus has largely been on understanding skills requirements for kind of Scotland's private sector employers, but we have been engaged with local authorities in a number of ways. So in terms of the Scottish Cities Alliance, which Jamie has just referred to, the Scottish Cities Alliance, we're part of the group of public sector partners who developed the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan. I attend the Scottish Cities Alliance Chief Executives group on a quarterly basis. I think one of the messages that comes out of that is that local authorities absolutely have an important role in delivering the transition to net zero and are already making important steps in terms of developing skills amongst their workforce. In relation to just the specific that was raised on the earlier panel this morning, we supported the Royal Town Planning Institute specifically around the planner study to look at where the bottlenecks and where the challenges were around the recruitment of planners. And I'm not going to rehearse again the evidence that you may have heard this morning, but an observation that I'd offer as a former planner myself is that one of the challenges that local authorities face, and I think this plays out across a range of disciplines, is the retention of staff. So, you know, I have countless colleagues who started their careers as planners in local authorities who are now working in a whole range of settings, from, you know, wind farm through development through to property development through to finance, which is not related to the initial part of their career. And I think that's a challenge that local authorities, we know they've faced it in relation to early years learning and childcare, when there was a significant expansion, there were concerns about people moving out of into local authorities, into the private sector. I suspect we'll see that played out across the transition to net zero as well over the next 3 to 5 years.
And is Skills Development Scotland working with the Scottish Funding Council feeding into government where you see potential bottlenecks? And bearing in mind you talked about over £1 billion of investment in the wider education aspect, and on top of that, there's other green funding and green investment net zero funding from government. Do you see that the the bottlenecks that you've described, and we heard from the earlier panel, being an area where actually we might get best value if we want to try and enable things to happen, is to actually look at planning, for example, and other areas of local authorities to enable that net zero agenda to be fully realised.
So one of the major pieces of what we're doing with the Scottish Government at the moment is a Pathfinder project looking at the entirety of the skills that we think are going to be required for the transition to net zero over the next 10 years. And that's focused on understanding where jobs are likely to materialise and when. Do we have sufficient insight into what specific skills requirements will be? And critically, do we have a clear understanding of the extent to which that provision is in place across private training provision, colleges and universities? Now, the way I describe that there, it sounds breathtakingly simple. That's a very complex piece of work that's underway and well underway at the moment. Where I think that allows Scottish Funding Council and Scottish SDS working with regional partners is to look specifically at where those bottlenecks are beginning to appear and to ask the question of the skills system, and particularly our colleges and universities, about the extent to which they can respond to that. So that $1.8 billion that I referred to in terms of post-16 education and skills investment, about $100 million of that is through apprenticeships. The vast bulk of that resource is through our college and university sector. And I'm not for a second suggesting that there may not be a requirement for additional resource to meet the scale of the challenge that's facing us. I think it's contingent on us to make best use of the resource that we actually have in the system at the moment.
Thank you. And if I can move on to Simon Hewitt now. Simon, you talked about the need to probably scale up on net zero skills and training in a similar way as happened with the big expansion for early years educators. So I'd like to hear more about that. And obviously, we've also heard that the supply and demand is planned on a very local basis, and colleges are very well placed to do that and very adaptable and flexible. In my own area, West Lothian College, I've actually, with funding from the Scottish Government and councils in West Lothian, working with private builders, are actually building a traditional house for retrofitting and a passive house for skills and retraining. Is that sort of thing happening right through colleges, and what more can be done to make sure that agenda is properly seized on?
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, there are excellent examples right across the country. And I guess that's one thing that colleges do particularly well, is work well with industry partners, both, you know, small and large. Some of the examples that are happening, you know, Dumfries and Galloway have their Green Skills Academy, Ayrshire College have their wind turbine technician programme, West College Scotland are working on microgeneration. My own college, Dundee and Angus, is working closely with the MSIP, the Michelin Scotland Innovation Park. So there's a lot of really strong partnership working, and a lot of local regional planning happening in this space. I think from my point of view, one of the big catalysts, and a catalyst that certainly within our region has been good, is the city deals and how you know, the green agenda, green skills, is absolutely at the heart of the regeneration and the city deal approach that has been put in place there. So there is a catalyst there to focus around that. So for us, we have brought around key partners around the table to really understand the supply side, because I think we also have to be realistic in this area that whilst there's a lot of knowns in terms of skills, there's a lot of unknowns in the sense of the direction of travel, what will be needed, how that will be delivered. So the key really is to work in partnership for that supply and demand piece. And it shouldn't be seen as just a college or a university or a training provider that's providing this. It needs to be a joined up approach. Otherwise, you risk duplication of funding, you risk duplication of effort. And, you know, for me, those great examples that I've mentioned across Scotland right now are definitely helping, and colleges playing a role as sort of anchor institutions in that, that really do know their communities. They've already got great infrastructure in place in a sense of apprenticeships, reaches into colleges, into schools. You think around 12% of school kids in Scotland are undertaking some education within colleges. So there's a really good opportunity here to start blurring the lines, I would say, between who does what and actually properly work together in a joined up fashion.
And could I just ask Simon just one final question for me? You mentioned city deals and obviously what's happening in the Dundee Tayside city deal. Do you think because it was one of the later city deals, it's potentially got more focus on sort of net zero skills delivery than perhaps some of the earlier city region deals that were established?
I think given the nature of what has happened over the past few years, particularly, where we are in the climate emergency, the climate emergency skills action plan launch, it's absolutely inevitable that yes, there's more of a focus within this one. But in saying that, there's also been over the past 2 years a massive shift in a sense of how we work together based on the pandemic. So even from my early involvement in the Tay Cities deal to where it is now, there's a shift and a change in attitude and focus and approach. And I think, you know, if I'm asking around what could be done more is, you know, in my honest opinion, funding drives behaviours. So where there's competition, where there's duplication, that drives the behaviours in that. Effectively, what you've got in the likes of the city deal and indeed some higher level initiatives is a real drive for partnership, a real drive for focus to work together. And certainly we see the best coming out when that's the case.
Thank you very much, Camina.
Thank you, Fiona. Next up is Mark Ruskell, to be followed by Liam Kerr. Over to you, Mark, please.
Yeah, thanks. Morning to you all. I wanted to ask you, Chris, about the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan. I mean, obviously this has a longer term outlook, I think, for the next 25 years. But there's a specific period that this plan relates to, which is 2020 to 2025. And obviously, we're coming up to the midpoint in that plan now. So can I ask you about how that plan is evaluated? How will you know whether that's successful in terms of delivering its objectives around climate?
Sorry, I was just waiting for my mic to come off then. Apologies. Thank you for the question. And you're right, the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan takes a kind of long-term view, a relatively long-term view in terms of skills plans, and that it focuses out to 2030. The plan was published in December 19. I'm forgetting which year because of the impact of the pandemic. I'm pretty sure it was 2019. Over the last, it was 2020, my apologies. We published the plan in December 2020. We've been focusing on what we've described, an initial kind of three-year programme of action that's been quite broad-based. So there's an element of the plan which is about addressing some of the issues we've heard about this morning, about engaging young people, about the future of careers in terms of the climate emergency. There's a significant piece of work underway which I described a few moments ago to Ms Hislop around understanding the extent to which we are currently investing in green skills and the scale of the delta that we need to close out in terms of future demand. There's a significant focus on upskilling and reskilling using the National Transition Training Fund programme and also the Green Jobs Workforce Academy. The plan has been developed by SDS, but it's not an SDS plan. This is a plan that we see very much as being co-developed with Scotland's colleges, Scotland's universities, with the Funding Council and other agencies. The Implementation Steering Group, who oversee the plan, get regular progress reports on the measures that are in the plan, and we're expecting that evaluation of the plan will be carried out towards the back end of that 2025 period. I think it's fair to say that I think we've made a good start, but the scale of the challenge that's ahead of us is pretty significant, and I would hope and anticipate that we see an increased ramping up of activity over the next 3 years. And for those reasons, the evaluation of the plan has not yet commenced. We'll commence that at the right and appropriate time.
Right. I mean, how responsive is that plan then to changing government policy, changing circumstances? I mean, we've now got a massively ambitious heat and building strategy. although obviously there are questions, inevitable questions around delivery of that. Does that not provide quite a new context for the plan that needs reconsidered?
And the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan Implementation Steering Group is absolutely alive to that. So we've just created a decarbonisation of heating buildings, a subgroup of the ISG that's looking specifically at the opportunities and the challenges. We've created similar groups of interest, including employers around issues like transport. But the point you make is very well made. The plan can't be a straitjacket around which we're, you know, slavishly focused on solely delivering that. This is an emerging area in terms of Scottish Government's policy commitment. And from a skills perspective, skills will be driven by investment and demand. So we're very alive to the need to be very close to government policy and for the plan to respond to that. What we don't necessarily want to do is to be rewriting the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan every 12 months. So we anticipate that there will be a refresh of the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan in about 2023-24, but that we keep the plan as a live document that responds to emerging care policy changes and other changes in the landscape.
Yeah, thanks. And then, you know, I'm sure you caught some of the session this morning. As you said, you're a former planner yourself. I did look through the document and I could find one reference to planning and planning jobs in there, and it was in a sort of list of potential areas for you know, skills development. There didn't seem to be a particular focus on planning and planners. Is that something that you kind of recognise needs to change, particularly given the amount of infrastructure we're going to need to build, the amount of placemaking and changes that are going to be needed in communities?
Yeah, I think it's a fair point in terms of I haven't gone through the document with a planner's eye to recognise the number of references to planners, but one of the challenges with the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan is that we are recognising the transition to net zero is going to impact right across the economy. It's going to impact on the hospitality sector. It's going to impact on food and drink. So there's a piece where the lack of name checking of planners in the plan isn't a reflection of the importance of that as an area of work. As I said a few moments ago, we co-commissioned with the Royal Town Planning Institute. Again, I'm going to get my years wrong, but I'm pretty sure this one was 2020. And we co-commissioned some work with the Royal Town Planning Institute to look specifically at the challenges in terms of the recruitment of planners and what might be done to address that. And again, you know, the issues that it's uncovering, I've rehearsed some of them in the committee this morning. It's around, you know, the supply of planning schools in Scotland, the supply of planning provision, contracting. You know, it's largely a postgraduate kind of endeavour. In my day, there were two or three planning schools delivering undergraduate kind of capabilities. I think the planning profession has changed kind of significantly. Yeah, again, I look back to my experience as a planner in Strathclyde in the late 1990s. A number of people who were on that course were reskilling and retraining through that university degree. They were based in a building control department or a planning department as a technician in a local authority, and they were upskilling. So some of those routes into upskilling and reskilling for planners absolutely need to be addressed.
Okay, thanks for that. Final question actually is for Jamie. I mean, obviously you're working on developing those partnerships with local authorities, you know, to tackle climate change. And there'll be some big areas there, I would imagine, around heating and energy alongside transport. Can you tell me a bit about who you see as being the biggest partners for local authorities to engage in? You know, where is that big workforce for delivery actually going to come from? Because thinking about energy, is it the utility companies that are going to come in and do street-to-street retrofit, you know, whether that's investing in district heating schemes or doing, you know, household insulation or whatever? Where is that big workforce? Because I guess when I look at housing departments within local councils, I'm not seeing a vast workforce there to be deployed to retrofit and change entire communities. So what is that? Where is the partnership there? Where is the bulk of that workforce, say in an area like energy, that can engage in partnership working with councils to really make the shift to net zero?
Yeah, I mean, again, you've touched on a lot there. And context for this, I mean, local authorities in setting area-wide targets, which they have for their emissions, are taking on a huge challenge, of which they have direct or in control over maybe 6% of in terms of emissions from their local area. So they absolutely cannot deliver this alone, and they absolutely need to find ways of bringing in local partners to help deliver that. Of course, what we've seen so far is closer links with other members of the public sector, because they all have reporting and targets to meet. What we're helping them to bring together through things like the Edinburgh Climate Compact are more innovative partnerships with the private sector. And to, I suppose, to come around to your question, what we're seeing that might be more innovative is where actually new players are coming into the market, new energies that have different business models and different ways of working, different experiences from other countries, actually. For you mentioned district heating schemes there, the sort of business models that we're seeing that might work and the people who have experience in delivering them, not necessarily in the UK. You know, there are organisations like Vattenfall who we're doing some work with, who are looking at business models for how you can introduce district heating into Edinburgh. And it's complicated, and it does need, it needs a completely different skill set. You know, we've spent a bit of time there talking about planners and the need for planning skills. You're not going to turn planners into carbon accountants, but you do need to build that sort of capacity in both local authorities and the private sector to ensure that climate impact is assessed in whatever decision you make by whatever department you make it. And planning is a very big part of that. That's maybe people working together rather than a kind of development of the planning skills. Sorry, I've gone slightly off beam on your question there, but the partners, yes. Anyone that you know kind of interacts on that critical piece. And one of the big obstacles we see here actually is in finance. You know, we've done some work on economic impact assessment on economic assessment of the measures we need to take to get to net zero. And they show, and we hear this consistently, investment in climate is a good investment, an investment that pays it for itself. But there's a missing, there's a gap between projects, good climate projects being brought forward and those reaching institutional investment. And there's a specific skill there that's needed, I think, in order to bridge that gap in kind of aggregating projects, articulating business cases, and presenting them to the investment community. And if we can get that right, if we can bridge that gap by working with that community, I think we'll unlock a lot of the both economic potential and a lot of the sort of latent pent-up demand for both investment and project delivery, which we're seeing on both sides. There's an awful lot in that, but that's a pretty critical part of industry that we should work with. And they say they want to work with us. It's just finding the kind of mechanics to make that work.
Have you got examples of where that kind of expertise and capacity to manage and develop those kind of new partnerships is working well in local authorities?
I wish I could say yes. there are models that we see where that knowledge is being built and that capacity is being built, and there are organizations, different forms of investment companies that are kind of bringing those innovative models forward. But there's not enough, that there is still a big gap. So I wish I could say, yes, we can see it being done, and it's being done here, and it's being done this way, and you can all learn from that. There's a missing middle to this, you know, this building the pipeline of investable climate projects and linking them up with institutional investors in a way that makes all of that flow a lot easier. And you know, some of the Scottish Government agencies may be able to, people like SNAIB might have a role in supporting that, some of them.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, Mark, thank you very much. Next up, Liam Kerr, to be followed by Monica Lennon. Liam, over to you, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. I'll direct my first question to Chris Brodie, please. Chris, the number of green jobs in Scotland has been declining in recent years. I saw last week, and in a response to a parliamentary question that I submitted, that the Scottish Government is considering changing the definition of what constitutes a green job. Has Skills Development Scotland been involved in those discussions and planning, given presumably the impact on skills development that would presumably occur?
Great, thank you. And yes, we have been involved in those discussions, and I'd maybe refer you to a part of the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan where we talk about the importance of having a real clear understanding and definition of what a green job is. And there isn't one out there. We looked across kind of international standards and didn't find one that fits the purpose, particularly in terms of skills. So in the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan, we talk about three types of jobs. We talk about existing jobs that we know we're going to need more of. Great example of that, we've already heard this morning in terms of planners. We're talking about jobs that already exist, but that will require significant upskilling and reskilling. And again, we've had a conversation around, you know, the conversion of gas boiler engineers into you know, heat pump engineers, and that will play out across other disciplines. And then thirdly, the CSAT talks about those new jobs around emerging technologies which don't even exist. The work that we did suggested that a lot of attention gets focused on that third group. It's about the new jobs that we anticipate might come through new technologies. In reality, the delivery of the transition to net zero, particularly in the early years, is going to be delivered through that second group, we think, through upskilling and reskilling of existing jobs and reskilling people to be able to address some of the challenges of the transition to net zero. That's a kind of very contextual answer. The work that we've got underway is working with University of Warwick and University of Strathclyde to look at how you then translate that framework into a measurement definition that helps you better capture both the demand side, so when do we expect green jobs to appear and of what type, but critically from the provision side. So an issue I've raised regularly through the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan, and again I've raised this morning, is we need to understand the extent to which the investment, the significant investment we're already putting into the skills system, hits one of those three measures. You know, to what extent are we well equipped to provide, you know, the planners of the future? To what extent is that investment bent towards upskilling and reskilling? What's the capacity in the system to be able to develop training provision for jobs which at the moment do not yet exist? That work is due to complete later on in the spring. I don't have the exact date for that, but I can provide that to the committee. And we expect that definition will be the subject of some refinement and discussion between the partners who will be using it to inform the work that we do demand and the work that we do on understanding the extent to which your investment already plays into green jobs.
Thank you. I'd be very grateful if you could provide that later, if you wouldn't mind, Chris Brodie. Simon Hewitt, on the upskilling and reskilling, particularly that Chris has just talked about, the convener asked earlier on about training required. Now, I recall in the previous session I sat on the Public Audit Committee, and I seem to recall that the number of college places has been significantly cut in recent years. I seem to recall it was over 150,000 places have gone. And I also recall reading in January in one of the newspapers that colleges were facing a £51.9 million cut in funding. So Simon Hewitt, does that landscape have an impact on our prospects of achieving net zero? And if so, is there any sign of the Scottish Government recognising and addressing the need for greater funding and more college places, do you think?
Thank you. Yeah, a really important question. Just to kind of build a little bit on Chris's point around that upskill and reskilling piece, you know, it is right across all sectors, just thinking about low carbon transport as well. I mean, I think even to upskill the existing technicians out there in motor vehicle, you know, there's around 36,000 people needed upskill. That's before any new rules come in. So a significant job to be done in a multitude of different sectors to try and prepare us for net zero. And yes, most definitely there has been challenges. I think, as you've mentioned, the draft budget will have a significant impact. Colleges now will have to step back and make some pretty difficult decisions around what they prioritise and what they don't. And I guess it's the knock-on impact of that, of if you're prioritising net zero and the transition to net zero, then something else will not be prioritised. And that's the kind of realism of the difficult decisions that will need to be made, because in actual fact, to truly deliver what we need to deliver requires investment. You know, thinking about colleges' infrastructures alone, you know, there's a significant amount of infrastructure that, you know, college buildings need support on. You know, this area and a sense of equipment that is needed to try and get it to industry standard will require investment. So actually, yes, it is likely to have an impact on the delivery to net zero. And if anything, you know, we should be calling for investment into this area and some ring-fence funding to allow colleges and indeed others to really tackle this challenge that we're all about to face.
I'm very grateful. Convener, I'll take one more small question, if I may. And as I'm remote, I'm just going to do it. Chris Brodie, if I can just come back to you, because something occurred to me as you were speaking. In an earlier response during this session, you talked about there being a trebling of the workforce to achieve net zero. Is there a straight correlation here, such that to treble the workforce, there needs to be a trebling of the budget available for funding the sort of courses that Simon's just been talking about, or does it not work quite like that?
It's a great question, and I don't think it works like that, if I'm being honest. I come back again to the reality is that we invest very heavily as a nation in terms of post-16 education. And I think Simon's right that what we need to ensure is that some of that investment is actually investing in the system to support it to change. But I think we need to be able to ensure that we're making best use of that £1.8 billion investment post-16 education. And it answers the question, to what extent is it supporting our economic growth ambitions, whether they be around green skills, whether they be around digital. That's a centrepiece of the National Strategy for Economic Transformation's focus on skills. You know, so we recognise that the public sector kind of funding settlements are unlikely to treble over the next 10 years, I would hazard a guess. So it's very much about ensuring that we make effective use of the existing resources in the system, that we apply additional resources where they're available to effect change. I think that needs to be the answer, but it's not a straight correlation to say we need to treble this budget or treble that budget.
Very grateful. Convener, I have no further questions.
Okay, Liam, thank you very much. Next up is Monica Lennon, to be followed by Jackie Dunbar. Monica, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. I want to ask about the Green Jobs Workforce Academy, so probably best for Chris to pick this up. I will admit I've been a little bit sceptical about the Green Jobs Workforce Academy because it seems to me to be a very fancy website, but I'm not sure how much value we're getting out of it. So, Chris, I know it's only been about 6 or 7 months since it launched, but can you give us a flavour of how it's actually helping local authorities and their workforce in terms of the technical skills and I think the soft skills that Simon talked about? I know you talked about evaluation, I think, around about 2025, but how will we be able to check in and see if that's having a sort of practical benefit to local authorities in the months and years ahead?
Sure, thanks. And it's a really good question. I think it's really helpful to set a bit of context about what the Green Jobs Workforce Academy is and what we want it to be. And, you know, the initial iteration of the Green Jobs Workforce Academy Phase 1 was part of the government's 100-day commitment. We had a number of kind of underlying principles that informed the development of both the first phase and the future phases of the Green Jobs Workforce Academy, and some of these I've referenced today. So the first is that recognition that actually upskilling and reskilling is going to be a really important part in our armoury in terms of getting
sales out to people for the transition to net zero. The second is that the transition to net zero plays out across the entirety of the economy, but it will play out in some areas, it will play out importantly in some areas first. I think the third one is absolutely recognising that there's a significant world-class asset in Scotland in the shape of 45 further and higher education institutions who are delivering, you know, HNCs, HNDs, degrees, and they're also doing upskilling and reskilling. And I suppose, allied to that, one of the things that we saw emerging really rapidly as a result of COVID was that move to kind of online learning and delivery. So all of those components, I think, informed that first phase of the Green Jobs Workforce Academy. It doesn't have a physical presence, although the courses that are developed and can be accessed through the Green Jobs Workforce Academy do, of course, take place in either they can take place online, they can take place in colleges or in universities and institutions. Our ambition for the Green Jobs Workforce Academy, and there's work underway around all of this, is in a number of areas. One, ensuring that it's communicating information on employment opportunities as they emerge right across the transition. I think the second is to help better educate people who might want to reskill or upskill about where they need to do that and how they do it. So we're currently developing a kind of skills, a further iteration of the skills discovery tool, which will allow people to go in and say, I think I fancy a job in area X, my skills are, and they will get a dedicated report which articulates to them where they need to upskill, where that upskilling is available and where some funding is available. We're also kind of building the functionality so that it engages people with our Army of Careers Advisors. We've got 800 careers advisors working across schools and providing adult CIAG advice. So people engaging with the Workforce Academy will be able to kind of book an appointment in time with our advisors. And finally, we're also exploring the concept of a green skills wallet, where there will be funding that's attached to, you know, individuals potentially on a kind of graduated basis, in the sense that, you know, people with lower skills potentially get additional funding to undertake upskilling and reskilling. So it's very much a piece of work that I think is an academy that will continue to grow and develop over the coming years. In terms, you're right to point out it's only been running 6-7 months. So at the moment, what I don't have for you is detailed performance information, but as that becomes available, we'll be sharing that firstly with the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan Implementation Steering Group, and that, of course, will be available in time to share with colleagues in government and in Parliament.
Thank you. I appreciate it's probably early days to produce that data, but will you be collecting data, for example, on how many local authority workers have accessed the academy and have gone on to undertake training, for example? I think it would be helpful to know, particularly in terms of our inquiry, what that interaction is between, you know, local authority workers and the academy.
Yeah, I don't have a direct answer to that at the moment, I'm afraid. What I would say is, like all of our training programmes, our training support is agnostic to whether you're working in an SME in Shetland, a local authority in Glasgow, or a big bank in Glasgow or Edinburgh. I need to confirm with the team who are operating the academy the extent to which that information is available and what some of the challenges might be in collecting that. But again, happy to undertake to respond to the committee and respond to you specifically in a bit more detail on that issue.
That's great, thank you. I know we're pushed for time. I had another question, it won't surprise, about planning, given our earlier session. I feel like I'm putting Chris under the spotlight, but he has told us he's also a former planner. The points that were made about planning apprenticeships, which exist in England, is that something Skills Development Scotland is looking at? And I was interested also, I think it was Simon who talked about colleges as anchor institutions. So we've talked a lot about routes into planning, especially through university, but we've not really heard about opportunities in further education and other routes for planning technicians, for example. So if we maybe could get a few words on planning apprenticeships from our panellists, that would be great. And I'll come back to Chris.
So, of course, the recommendation to explore a planning apprenticeship was one of the recommendations of the report that we co-published with
Royal Town Planning Institute. I think the issue is less about an apprenticeship framework per se, and about workplace learning and workplace training. And I refer back to some of the comments I made a few moments ago. So when I trained as a planner at Strathclyde on my course, there were two or three colleagues who were actually embedded within planning departments and were doing their training kind of part-time. And I think what we're exploring is what is the best route to broaden those opportunities into the planning profession? Is it actually about having a new planning apprenticeship, a graduate apprenticeship, or is it actually about, you know, amending the kind of the format and the content of existing courses? I think a critical thing in all of that is recognising that the planning profession is quite different from what it was certainly when I trained. So there's an underlying piece of it ensuring that, you know, the nature of planning education in Scotland is, yes, it's there and the roots are there, but it's also kind of up to date as well.
Thank you, Simon.
I wish I'd never outed myself. I wish I'd never outed myself as a former planner now.
It's okay. Welcome to the club. Simon, I don't know if Jamie wants to add anything, but yeah, over to Simon.
One of the things, particularly within further education within colleges, is the ability to add a breadth of different skills and subjects within courses. So, you know, we begin effectively SCQF 1, 2, 3 upwards. So we can actually, one of the roles and a key role that the college sector can play is given that at least initial understanding, the early level skills, awareness of not just planning, but a wide range of different sectors, a wide range of different job roles. And I know that's one of the, particularly within transition to net zero and the climate emergency, you know, as a sector, we have around 240,000 students every year. So we actually have a role and responsibility to help raise awareness of the actual climate emergency, but as well as the potential roles within that. And I know some specific colleges do have planning units within that. My own college, which has a tie-in to Dundee University, has specific elements of planning within that, but again, at an early awareness-raising stage. So that's where colleges are contributing at this point in time, not just in planning, but in a wide range. And effectively, we are really keen to use the size and scale of the college sector to ensure as many people are aware of the climate emergency and indeed that broad kind of pathway into the routes that they can go down.
Great, thank you. I'm not sure if Jamie did want to add anything.
Well, Simon's kind of answered it for me. The as well as the specific careers here, the challenge is to embed climate impact and climate knowledge across all professions and across all courses, so that anyone who's entering the labour market now sees that as a critical part of delivering whatever job it is that they take on.
Great, thank you, Jamie. Back to you, convener.
Okay, Monica, thank you very much. Jackie Dunbar, please.
Thank you, and good morning, or good afternoon now, panel. Simon, you said earlier on that we need to blur the lines of who's responsible for what in terms of education and training, etc. And I couldn't agree more. I think I was speaking earlier about some education should be started at primary school level and upwards. With that in mind, can I ask what local authorities are doing to work with you to make sure that that's happening? And, you know, are they informing you of their priorities when they're setting their budget so that you know what to expect from them? Sorry, your microphone's not on.
Oh, apologies. I mean, I think that's a really excellent question. I guess what education can be very good at times is siloing itself, not even just in the sense of school, colleges and universities, but actually within departments in own institutions. You know, if you think about skills of the future, you know, multiple skills are needed across multiple roles. You know, it's no longer just a computing course. Computing is embedded within almost every course that is done now. So that sort of perception now is needs to change. I think we need to look much broader across what are the soft skills that are preparing young people and indeed adult returners to go into the job market. So yes, there is definitely a sense, I can only speak from my own local authority, where we have been heavily involved. We have been able to influence some of the strategic priorities, and we've put a real emphasis on school-college partnership. There's been a recent report that was launched through CDN College of Scotland around the role of colleges in that school-college partnership, how we can help build capacity. We know that there's challenges for teachers in these specific areas. We know that there's challenges with equipment and infrastructure. So we need to be able to blur the lines of what is a college education, what's a school education. Actually, it's just an education, an option and a choice and a pathway that shouldn't matter if it's done in school or done in a college. So I think there is a realisation and awareness. I do know that it's very different across local authorities right across Scotland. There's very different approaches. And even the basic challenges of aligning timetables in the school day is a real, you know, it's the simple things that are causing some of the bottlenecks. And I think where we could make a significant impact is recognising the importance of that sort of school, college, university joint working piece. Actually have clear aligned days, clear strategic priorities within each region, and properly working collectively together to really tackle this, because I do think it's going to take that whole education system approach to allow that to happen.
Thank you. If I can move on to Chris now. Chris, you mentioned earlier about needing more folk back to work, and we need more routes for training, for upskilling and retraining. Can I ask a really simple question? Is what do you mean by retraining? Folk who are already in the industry or coming into an industry for the first time? I'm asking because you know, folk out there who you know, moving over in the just transition stuff, are maybe not aware of what information is out there to go and find out about, do I need to retrain or do I need to reskill, and what's the difference? I hope I'm kind of making sense when I'm asking that question. And also, what can our local authorities do to build the capability and capacity that was being spoken about before? Not only, of course, for their own workforce, but also to help the private sector, sorry.
Yes, you're absolutely right to draw the distinction between retraining and upskilling. And I suppose in simple terms, an example of upskilling would be someone building on their existing skills in a job or in a company that allows them to be more effective at delivering their job. And in relation to you know, the transition to net zero, as I've said several times, that's got to be an important component. Retraining is about more in the space of moving from one job or sector or company kind of into another. So it's about a fundamental, you know, kind of reshift, moving from, I'm trying to think of an example, moving from being a civil servant like myself to being an engineer would require not me to be upskilled, but to be, you know, significantly retrained. I think the reality of our training system in Scotland, our education skill system in Scotland, is quite rightly, for a long time, we've been focused on that transition from school into the labour market. So a huge proportion of our investment, and I include our modern apprenticeships in this as well, has been focused on people aged 18 to 24. And I think one of the challenges that we're wrestling with is how do we create the space in the system to focus on the challenges of the next 10 years, not the last 20. So that will, we've heard the phrase difficult choices several times being used by Simon today, but part of the issue the system, I think, needs to wrestle with is how do you rebalance that investment towards a more balanced portfolio of kind of training routes that meet
the labour market and the skills needs of the future. I think one of the issues that's brought, several issues that's brought this into sharp focus has been what's happened as a combined result of, you know, our decision to leave, the UK's decision to leave the EU, as well as the COVID pandemic. So you've had this choke on labour supply, for want of a better term, where we've fewer people kind of coming into the country, and many of those who came in have gone, you know, may have gone home. And secondly, you know, I mentioned this right at the outset. Apologies, someone's calling me on my mobile, so I'm just telling that off. Apologies for that. We've also seen a significant increase in economic inactivity. So there's something like 286,000, and I've probably quoted the number wrong, but there's 286,000, there's nearly 823,000 people who are classed as economically inactive and not available for work. And at a time of significant labour shortages, we need to be thinking quite hard about we bring some of those people back into the labour market to address skills shortages. And again, retraining will be a really important part of that.
Thank you very much. That's all I have, convener.
Okay, Jackie, thank you very much. We are up against the clock, but I wanted to follow up briefly with Chris on Monica Lennon's question on the Green Jobs Workforce Academy. As you'll appreciate, Chris, there's a bit of confusion on exactly what the Academy is about, but you helped to clarify that. Can I ask, is there a dedicated budget for the Academy? And if so, what is that budget? Just to give us a scale, a sense, some context of the scale of resource being put into the Academy.
I will provide a written answer to that, convener, in danger of misstepping over a number or a statistic. What I would say is that that's not necessarily a straightforward question to answer, and let me just explain why. There is a dedicated budget for the delivery of the Green Jobs Workforce Academy as a site and as a kind of concept, and we can provide those details in due course. But of course, what I'm not in a position to track is the extent to which training that's undertaken through the Academy. So if an individual goes in through the Academy, goes into a course in Lewes Castle College or in Simon's College, we are not at the moment routinely tracking the financial contribution towards that. So we will be able to provide an answer in terms of the dedicated budget to the Green Jobs Workforce Academy, but the way it's designed will draw an existing resource already in the skills system. I hope that makes sense in terms of the challenge in answering that question directly just now.
No, it does, Chris, and I very much appreciate that. And if you could provide what you suggested in writing to the committee, that would be very much appreciated. That does bring us to the end of our time. So let me thank the panel again. We covered, I think, a significant number of issues. Thank you very much for your insights and for setting out your views on some of the challenges faced in this area. That brings us to the end of the public session. So I now close the public part of the meeting. Thank you very much.